Amen. I just have one question. Who gave this woman? Ephesians chapter 5 and verses 25 through to 29 says, "Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself." 29 and last. "For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church." At this time, we will have a special rendition with yours truly and Sister Johnson.
I pray you'll be our eyes and watch us where we go, and help us to be wise in times when we don't know. Let this be our prayer. When we lose our way, lead us to a place, guide us with your grace, to a place where we'll be saved.
I pray we'll find your light.
I pray we'll find your light.
Hold it in our hearts.
And hold it in our hearts.
When stars go out each night.
When stars go out each night.
Remind us where you are.
Remind us where you are.
Let this be our prayer.
Let this be our prayer.
When shadows fill our day.
Oh, when shadows fill our day.
Oh, Lord, lead us to a place. Guide us with your grace. To a place where we'll be saved. Sorrow will be end. what's broken will be mended, and we'll remember we are of God's children, reaching out to touch you, reaching to the sky.
Just from above,
we hope it's all will find.
We hope it's all will find
another soul to love.
Another soul to love.
Let this be our prayer.
Let this be our prayer.
Just like every child.
Just like every child.
Needs to find a place. Guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be saved.
Needs to find a place.
Guide us with your grace. Give us faith so.
Good evening, everybody. It's my first time being a maid of honor. I thank the Lord for the AY Society. Many times a bridesmaid, but first time a maid of honor. All right, brothers and sisters. God loves weddings, doesn't he? He sure does. And I will ask your permission while I add my quota of welcome to our members who are in sanctuary, as well as our members who are viewing us on the Andrews Memorial Seventh-day Adventist YouTube channel and our EJC virtual church YouTube channel, if you permit me to read the same verse that our minister read earlier. And it can be found in Genesis chapter 2 and reading from 22 to 25. And Adam and Eve, you're very familiar with this one. And the rib, which the Lord God had taken from man, made he a woman, and brought forth unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Reading onward to 24. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. In this verse we see Eve moving from being called woman to wife. And so Amor and Renee, I think we can infer in our context that God was the first marriage officer. Is that a reasonable assumption, brothers and sisters? I'd also like to say that God is interested in the little details. He's interested in the big details. He's a particular God. And we also need to pay attention to details as well. If you recall, Jesus was attending a wedding in the book of Mark, Mark chapter 2 to be specific. He was attending the wedding of a family member. Now, I don't know if Jesus's relative was on the bride's side or the groom's side, but a family member nonetheless. It was his first public miracle. And you know the story. Jesus's mother said, I need your assistance. The family is going to be embarrassed. We're out of wine. And he said, woman, this is not my time. But knowing his mother, she ignored him and she said, servants, whatever Jesus tells you to do, follow him. And so we can read Mark chapter 2 and reading verses 8 to 10, where the servants brought the wine. And I have to tell you something about the wine. The biblical account is so exciting. It says that they use these large jars, and these large jars could hold up to 20 to 30 gallons of water. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? I'm not very good at math, but a simple math would tell me that Jesus made somewhere between 120 to 180 gallons of wine. Are you with me? The little details matter. And so in verse 8, then he told them, "No, draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so. And the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out their choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after. The guests have had too much to drink, but you have saved the best till now." And so what was Jesus doing? He was changing the concept. He was changing the custom. He was changing the tradition. The tradition is you wait until the last moment to bring out the cheap wine when everybody is feeling light and not realizing what was going on. But Jesus was calling them to establish a new custom, a new tradition, quality over quantity. Amen? And so this evening, we're here talking about, is it no time to change some of our wedding traditions? The entire program is based on us having a conversation about the origins, the antecedents of some of these traditions that we have seen from time immemorial. And we've never questioned them. We just know that whenever you're having a wedding, you need to have a flower girl sprinkling petals. Nobody questions it. We figure that if you're having a wedding, then there should be a bouquet toss, and nobody questions it. So this evening, our presenters who are going to come forward now, Sister Shanique Blake, Sister Shelly-Ann Morris, Sister Titania White, we're going to be sharing with you a few customs and talking back with you. Please feel free to put up your hands in the audience if you want to share. Also, we are going to be monitoring the chat. And right now, the first question I have to ask in the chat is, what are some of these customs and traditions that you have seen through time? Share them in the chat so we can talk. Hoping that you'll have a great evening. I'm excited, and I hope you're excited too. Come on, ladies. We'll start with Sister Blake.
Good evening, everyone. So I'll be looking at the tradition of jumping the broom, as well as the bachelor and bachelorette parties. So the first one, jumping the broom. So usually in this tradition, after a couple has exchanged vows, they'll hold hands and they'll jump over a broom. So the broom is usually passed down from generation to generation, or it will be made from scratch. It will have some ribbons tied to it, which represents the couple. The broomstick would represent God in certain instances, and then the bristles would represent family members and friends and well-wishers. But where did this custom come from? So from research, I've learned that where Africans are concerned, while persons were, our ancestors were enslaved, they weren't allowed to get married legally. And so this was their way of, you know, forming that marital union with their partners. It was used by others outside of them from other research that persons have done. And I've learned that it didn't originate with the Africans, because a lot of persons think that because now it's more practiced by Africans, but from research, persons are learning that it actually came from Europe, right? And you had persons who they weren't accepted by the church. They didn't worship the God that the church would have proclaimed at that time. And because of that, the church wouldn't sanctify or take part in the marital union. And so that was their way of, you know, coming together as man and wife. And so that is the more dated, you know, occurrence of that activity, right? Where the bachelorette party is concerned and the bachelor party is concerned, that is more dated to the era for the Spartans, right? So when a soldier is going to get married, they would have a dinner and they would toast that soldier, and that's where the bachelor party comes from. So coming down from that, you know, as certain tradition comes on, we add to it or we take away from it. And so we have, you know, certain activities being done now at bachelor parties where you have persons coming to dance, you have alcohol, and you have other entertainment being done. How it came to be something that women would have celebrated now, that came about after, you know, women would have tried to initiate some activities to express certain freedoms that men enjoy. And so we have the bachelorette party being birthed from that. So that's the, and of course, because of the turn that the bachelorette party took, you know, women decided to, you know, take it unto themselves, and a similar drinking and the like happens there. I'm hoping in the world, and not if it is that we decide that it's something that we take on here in the church. But that's the origin of the bachelor and bachelorette parties, as well as the jumping the broom tradition that is practiced, well, nowadays, mostly by Black persons. Thank you.
So do we have any questions or comments for Sister Shanique on what we have heard so far? Don't be bashful. Just to say that in the chat, a couple of persons have shared some traditions. Rochelle Olivier Thompson says the notion that the bride should be late for her wedding, and our bride was early this evening. Erica, were you late for your first wedding? No, she wasn't late for her first wedding either. Novelette Richardson also says you have the tradition of something borrowed, something new, something blue, something old as well. We also have, Novelette Richardson is also saying the tradition that the groom should not see the bride before she enters the church. And we're going to be talking about that. And Allison, the first dance, and Doreen Essen speaks about the tradition that the father should give away his daughter. Congregants, what traditions, customs have we seen over time? Just stick your hand up and let us know. Yes, sister. Wearing a white dress. All right, you're not a white dress kind of girl. All right. Anyone else? What other traditions have we seen with weddings? Sister Kay? The garter toss. Okay.
At that time, it would have been the Roman Catholic.
All right. We're having a microphone being placed in the center. Thank you. Anyone else wants to share about traditions or to comment on what you've just heard a while ago? All right, you can come to the microphone. So, Shanique, let me ask you a question. You shared with us about jumping the broom. So what alternatives could you perhaps suggest if persons should move away from jumping the broom now that they know the origins?
Okay, so there's another one that originated in Africa, which I really like. I might adopt it. Where they had, at the wedding, they had four containers. One with something that's sweet, bitter, hot, and something else. Just to signify the whole journey of being married. Because, well, some persons think that you will be smiling from ear to ear all the days of your life. But that's not the case. You will have some moments where things are bitter, things are hot, and of course things are sweet, and something else. So that's something that can be adopted.
Sour,
right? That's something that can be adopted to signify and to brace ourselves for what will happen.
Thank you so much. Abraham, you have a question.
What does jump the broom mean?
So in this scenario, you have a couple that just exchange vows. There is a physical broom in front of them. Do you have a broom at home? What does it look like?
like a stick with a brush?
Right. So in this instance, it's made of wood, right? So you have a broom, picture it, made of wood. You put it to lay flat on the ground. And the couple holds hand and jumps right over it. And that's jumping the broom.
Would you so like you have a physical
broom that you put down.
He might want a demonstration. Adam and Eve, could you just visualize a broom in front of you and jump so Abraham can see? Adam and Eve, could you just visualize a broom in front of you and just show Abraham what it means to jump? I think he wants a demonstration. Congregants, do you want a demonstration? Yes.
He says yes.
So you turn around so the viewers can see you and just visualize that imaginary broom and hold hands. Awesome.
I understand.
Okay. Awesome.
All right, so we're going to have Sister Titania White, and Titania is going to share with us on vows. She's also going to share with us on the size of the party, the dynamics of the bridal party, and she's going to come at it from a stewardship standpoint. And I think Sister Titania has something else special to share with us. Go ahead, Sister Titania.
Sabbath, everyone. So we're going to be talking about some topics that we might not have pondered on before. And first off, we're starting with our traditional vows. So, it says, take you, so, to be my lawfully wedded husband or wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse, for richer or poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish till death do us part. Those words are very familiar to a lot of us who have attended weddings, but do you know where they're from? This actually originates in the Book of Commons of the Anglican Church, and it goes back to the 16th century. However, they have found earlier versions in another religious book called the Sarum from the 11th century, and it's also associated with the Anglican Church. So, that is a clip of what the Book of Common looked like back in 1549 when it was established. So, that book in the 16th century was written by an archbishop called Thomas Cranham, and he is best known for assisting King Henry to divorce his wife. And that was back in the days when divorce was not a thing. He's also known as the father of the English Reformation. There is some suggestion that he might have been a Freemason. At the end of his life, he actually renounced. He had started Protestantism in England, and he was going to be killed for it. He renounced it. They were going to kill him anyways. And he had written an edict to say that he has renounced his faith. And when he realized that they were going to kill him anyways, it is said that he told them to burn his hands first as a demonstration to say that he made a mistake. So that's where it started from. There are some pictures on the screen. It might be hard for persons in the audience to see. This is from 1549. This is very, very old English. We are coming from far. So it also gives instructions that we still follow today. For example, at the top it says, first the banns must be asked 3 Sundays or holy days before the service. And if the individuals are from different parishes, it has to be said in all the parishes for both individuals. And there must be a single pastor that covers both parishes that is allowed to marry both persons. And the pastor is supposed to begin saying, dearly beloved friends, we are gathered together. And this is from 1549. So it continues to the next slide, where it says, And thou wilt thou have this woman to be thy wedded wife, to live together under God, after God's ordinance, in the holy estate of matrimony. Wilt thou love her, comfort her, honor, and keep her in sickness and in health? So this part would be something, would be a vow that the priest would say to each person, and they would agree. And then you would have the vows that we're familiar with, where you should have and to hold in sickness and in health. And it also indicates that the man should be holding the woman's hand. At a certain time, he should let go of her hand. Similar to what we see now, and at a certain time, he's supposed to hand over the tokens of spousage, such as the ring, and the ring should be gold or silver. And the priest is supposed to take away the ring and allow the husband to say another line. Now, this was interesting to me because back in those days, the man promised a lot. So before the prayer was said over the couple, the man had to say, "With this ring I thee wed, this gold and silver I thee give, with my body I thee worship, and with all my worldly goods I thee endow, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen." So that was the history of our vows. So, as for alternatives, before we go on to the flower girl, in the Christian community, it is being said that a lot of persons do not follow the vows as they are now. They do say vows of their own, but what they have found is a lot of persons have forgotten that this is an ordinance to God, and in their vows, they don't mention a pledge to God anymore. They mention, "When I saw you, your eyes were sparkling and my heart did a boop boop." There is no pledge to God where each individual is pledging to God that they are going to honor their marriage, they're going to honor this contract. And some believe that without that pledge in the vow, is it really a vow? So that's something to think about. So now we're going to move on to our flower girl. So, everybody loves a little pretty girl. She's walking down. We get to say, ooh and ah. But next slide. The flower girl originates from ancient Rome, and it was a symbol of fertility and prosperity and to ward off evil and jealous spirits. So, what we know now of the flower girl, how she looks, is coming from the Victorian era, but she actually goes back to the Roman Empire, where she was given sheaves of wheat and bouquets of herbs to bless the couple with fertility and prosperity. And then later in the 14th century, she was given garlic to ward off evil and jealous spirits. It wasn't until nearly the 16th century when flowers were incorporated into the traditional herb baskets for the little ones. So, I decided to look at it. What is the purpose? No, because a lot of us don't use it to ward off evil spirits anymore. What is the purpose? So according to what we believe now, the flower girl is actually a way of indicating that the bride is about to come down the aisle, and it's also a way of decorating the aisle. So what some persons have done when they don't no longer use a flower girl, they do a pre-decoration of the aisle, or they will put boxes of flowers on the side and allow the audience to participate in welcoming the bride. Some persons even have a special carpet for the bride. Just a way to introduce the bride without all the other symbolisms. And now we're on to the bouquet. The bouquet was a similar thing coming from the ancient Greeks and the Romans, even the Egyptians. And similarly, the flowers were a way to encourage fertility, and they also had spices to ward off bad luck during the wedding and also to cover body odor. So, some persons have, in today's day, the bouquet is just now a complimentary addition to the overall theme of the wedding and the style of the bride's dress. So some alternatives that persons have done is a decorative fan, parasols, as well as corsages. And then on to our final topic is the wedding party. So our bridesmaids and our groomsmen. Yes, this is very interesting history. The bridesmaids are coming from ancient Rome. They were originally a group of women that the bride's sisters are friends, and they attended the wedding dressed identically to the bride and acted as a decoy to confuse the spirits. Yes. So let me just add a little more. So traditionally, this was done because people feared evil spirits would come and curse the bride on her wedding day or whisk her away. So the bride acted as a matching decoy in order to confuse the spirits long enough for the bride to become happily married. So over time, the tradition of the multicolor has of the same color, we just put any color we feel like. But the entire bride of, okay, I'm going to do it separate as first. So that was the goal of the bridesmaid, not the groomsman. The origin is from ancient Rome and China, and it was to help carry the bride to the wedding. Now, I'm leaving that there for a reason. Let me read this out. So, in some traditions, the groomsmen were called bride's knights because they helped carry the bride to the wedding. The best case scenario, they were taking her from the disapproving relatives to be joined with the man she loved, protecting her from would-be kidnappers. The other more troubling scenario, they were the bride's kidnappers. It's believed that the best man role originated with 16th century Germanic Goths as the groomsman who kidnapped the bride. The best man then stood next to the bride during the ceremony to prevent other suitors or family members from taking her and to make sure she did not run away. So there are a lot of things that we do and we don't understand why we do it. There was also another, in all this bridal party, I believe the woman stand on the left of the man. And the reason for that was during those times, because the woman would be coming from far, and the village of the man, there would be other persons who want brides. They were afraid the bride would be kidnapped. And so the groom had to make sure that his right hand was available so he could defend his bride if necessary. So that's why she stands on the left. So is there an alternative to this? Not necessarily. But today there's a purpose for why we have the bridal party, and it actually is supposed to serve as a support system to the couple in their new marriage. However, this has kind of gotten away from some persons where as much bridesmaids as possible, we need all the colors of the rainbow. But you should have persons standing beside you who will counsel you into a good marriage. And finally, that's the end of the slide, but there is something else I would like to add. Finally, Trevin mentioned stewardship. So the average number of individuals in a bridal party is about 3 to 5 individuals. And in America, the average cost of a wedding is $20,300. Let's not convert that to Jamaican. However, if you were supposed to do a destination wedding to Jamaica, you know, that's just $4,652. And even if you convert that, that is still a headache. So, what really was the purpose of a wedding? The purpose of the wedding, one moment. So, a wedding ceremony was to function as to provide the bride and the groom an opportunity to make promises to each other. And I know the part of the wedding that has the most cost at time is the reception, but historically the reception was a way for the couple to receive their friends and families as their new couple, as their new selves, and for their friends and families to receive them. And the reception was DIY, where the two families got to know each other and to celebrate the couple. And last thing, some little facts. A study was done on extravagant marriages, and they found a correlation that persons who have extravagant marriages have a high chance of getting a divorce. And persons who contribute more to their honeymoon has a lower chance of getting a divorce. And also persons who contribute to the marriage and not just the one day. Thank you.
Do we have any questions in sanctuary for Sister Titania? Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry, sir. So sorry. Forgive me. I don't have on my glasses.
A pleasure and good afternoon to you all. In your presentation, you mentioned that the vows were made primarily to each other, excluding God. And I gather from your presentation as well, these vows and whatever you presented came from the church that we move away from. So my question is, do you have a format that you think you can follow from the Bible that would suit Seventh-day Adventists, especially in a situation where we see so many divorces in our church?
Okay, so first off, I mentioned that modern-day vows, not necessarily those of the Christian church, but just modern-day vows tend to not have a pledge to God. As for a format, as I was looking this up, I went to Ellen G. White, and she mentioned that there must have been a reason why God actually didn't gave us a format for a wedding. He only showed where in the Bible where there was joy, where they were celebrating the couple. And as long as we dedicate ourselves to God, I believe that's the best format that we can have. So there doesn't have to be a strict format. The reason why I brought up the traditional vows was, and why I looked into it, was because we kept saying these words. Where did the words come from? What do they mean? I know we add our own interpretation to the words, but who wrote the words? Why were they written? So I decided to look into it. Yes, it came from a church that we moved away from, but since we have kept using it in our church, I would like to believe that quite a number of our pastors saw where they still made sense and it could apply to us. So it was not like one of the other traditions that I mentioned where it was just 100% pagan. It seemed as if these vows were coming from a genuine place where they were trying to create a format so that persons knew what to say. But before this, before these books, these vows were in a book, it would have been, we would have made up a vow and add the pledge to God, adding that this is an ordinance and that we respect each other. So is there a format? I don't think so. But remember to pledge to God, the important part.
I just want to say, in response to the question that my brother posed, that it is not the format that contributes to the divorcement that is taking place in the church, but rather the hardness and stubbornness of the hearts of individuals. So we have to make sure that we don't confuse the issues, because in the Bible, Jesus never supported the whole issue of a divorce, but he said that because of the hardness of the heart issue a certificate of divorcement. And if we want our marriages in the church to survive, we have to understand that no two individuals who venture into marriage are the same. There are going to be differences, but it is how we deal with those differences. And as Christian people, we have to deal with them with love. And we have to make sure that we are prepared to compromise. If you are not prepared to compromise in the marriage, then you're never prepared to marry the person in the first place. All right?
I would just like to add that Ellen G. White also pointed to that idea. She mentioned that the young people get caught up in the idea of the feeling, and you feel so nice, and you continue feeling, but what happens after the feeling is gone? How do you interact with that partner? You got so caught up in being feeling good. When the feeling is gone, you feel as if you can't interact with the person. She encourages, when you're single, you should get to know yourself, understand your faults, work on yourself, your communication skills, because when you go into that partnership, you have to have those skills to exercise them to so that your marriage can grow beyond the first day.
Amen. Amen. Brother Michael, you had a question?
I was just saying, I noticed that most of these customs that we practice they are mostly Europeans, Rome, Greek. Why? We are Africans, and I know that the Africans have some good, you know, real traditional way of getting married. Why can't we practice, you know, some of these, you know, practices? Or why can't we adapt even some of them and, you know, incorporate them into our marriages?
You might have to help us with identifying them, Brother Michael, but that might be for another time. But
well,
give us one of them, no?
There is one that I know for sure that if whenever the gentleman takes my daughter, and if he doesn't give dowry, then it means that he's not fit enough to, you know, take care of my daughter. And why should a man come and, I grew my daughter all these years, and a man just come and take her without giving back something, or without showing that he's in a position to maintain her? You know,
so he should start maintaining you first.
Well, even more so. but not really. The doorway that he give shows that he's capable, you know, to maintain his wife, you know, more than just you know, I grew my daughter all over the years and giving her the best. And all of a sudden this man just come and say love her. Just like that and gone with her.
I hear you, Brother Michael. We want to address two questions arising from the EJC chat. I believe it's Sister Joan Morgan. She asked about the veil. From a contemporary standpoint, persons wear veils for decorative purposes because they like it. You know, just like fascinators, it's in keeping with your personal style. But in the Victorian era, back in the 18th century, the veil served a different purpose. For one, it has been said that the veil is to, as it were, veil the bride's face. So it's bad luck, it is said, for the husband to see the wife before she gets up to the altar. It has also been said that the veil keeps out dark forces as well. So we have all of these interesting antecedents. And so you have to be very careful as you decide to perpetuate, and you have to know what you are about. Also arising in the chat, there was a comment from Sister Doreen Esson, where she stated that one of the traditions is that a father should escort his daughter. And in keeping with what Brother Michael said a while ago, one of the primary reasons where historically, Brother Caballero, why a father would escort his daughter is because he's already received the money for the dowry. And so he has to ensure that the contract is completed. And the contract can only be completed after the wedding. So he has a vested interest in holding on to that young lady's hand to bring her to the altar to see the wedding through, because he's already accepted the dowry, Dr. Greaves. So in modern times, do we have to allow a father to escort his daughter to the altar? No, it's not necessary. Nothing is wrong with it happening, but it is not necessary. It's not necessary for a mom to do it. It's not necessary for the parents to do it, although we see it being done. But we can establish new traditions where when Pastor Blake or Pastor Johnson says, who gives this woman? And the entire audience says, we do, because this is our family. So yes, we can establish new traditions, and it's important to know where you're coming from. There's a question for Sister Shani before I do my presentation. Someone in the EJC chat also wants to ask about jumping the broom again to find out if the broom was an obstacle. They might have missed your presentation.
Sure, not a problem. So the broom represented, or jumping over the broom represented, jumping from the old life to the new life, a life of, you know, singleness to a life of togetherness with the man and woman. Another thing, it represented sweeping away too of the old and entering the new. So it's just a transition into a new phase and not necessarily an obstacle.
Men. All right, so I am going to quickly just share with you on two traditions and then give some suggestions of new traditions that one can adopt. So the first one has to do with tossing the bouquet. Now, the custom of tossing the bouquet dated back at least as early from the
18th century or even before. No, it was not just about tossing the bouquet, but it was felt that getting close to the bride, touching her clothes, Titania is laughing, would give you good luck. It would ensure that you would have the ability to get married soon. Unfortunately, back in the 18th century, sometimes things got out of hand, where it escalated to the part where women were actually tearing portions of the bride's outfit because they thought that preserving a piece of her fabric would give you good luck and ensure that you could find yourself a spouse. And so what happened is that the bride, in trying to make her big escape, would then toss the bouquet and run. So that is where it's coming from. So it was about persons getting into the bride's private space, wanting to touch her, wanting to get a piece of her clothing, and in an attempt to appease them, she would toss the bouquet. So let's talk about tossing the bouquet. It's cute, isn't it? We've seen it in different weddings. But let's think about it. Sometimes a master of ceremonies who is familiar with all of the single ladies, they will call them by name and they will say, "Will Sister Gabrielle, will you come forward? And Sister Charmaine is not single, but will Sister Charmaine come forward? And will Sister Raquel come forward?" And sometimes this can put people on the spot. Yes, brethren? Because sometimes a person has just recently come out of a bad relationship, recently widowed, recently divorced, or just a very private person. So it's all in good fun, but some persons don't always find it in good fun. Also, we know that marriage is a very holy institution. And so if we're talking about a holy institution, even in jest, do we want to trivialize it and say, the person who catches my bouquet is destined to get married next? No, I don't want to take away the fun from your wedding, but aren't there alternatives that we could come up with based on the antecedents? So perhaps you could have a game for singles, and whoever wins, they can get the bouquet. Or the bride, you have a very good friend who you think would make a wonderful wife, and you decide that you're going to go to your friend and you're going to pray with Sister Shanique, and you say, "Shanique, I'm hoping one day you'll be a bride soon. I'm hoping one day you'll be a mother." And you give her your bouquet without all the fanfare. There are some persons who also allow other persons to share in their spotlight and get engaged at their wedding. And so it probably would be a cute gift to pass on the bouquet and, for that matter, pass on the garter. All I'm saying is that having understood the antecedents and understanding that some of them may not have been so wholesome, it is grown for you to establish new traditions. The second one is what we call the hand fasting tradition. And I don't know if Sister Cunningham is still here, but maybe we could use our bride and groom as a demonstration. If you could just come and stand in front. Does any lady have a scarf that they could lend? Any scarves in the house? Who has a scarf? Oh no, we're not going to remove. Thank you so much, Sister Johnson. So the idea really would be that they would hold hands, and as it says, hand fasting. Or tying the knot. So hand fasting or tying the knot. You look cute. I will return this. Yes, that's it. So the hand fasting or tying the knot has been voiced around as being a Celtic tradition, a pagan tradition. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? And so the Celtics are persons who believe in giving worship to the elements, to the weather. It's something that has also been picked up in Scotland, where persons who are looking to elope would go to Scotland, because Scotland recognizes hand fasting or tying the knot as a legal ceremony. And so it's important to understand, again, the origins of some of these things that we do. It is said that the hand fasting or tying the knot is representative of the couple unifying, one flesh, coming together. But realizing what this particular tradition means, one can find other creative ways of demonstrating unity. Isn't that so? Yes. So persons have the sand ceremonies. There are persons who have seed ceremonies. There are persons who use crystals of different colors to show the differences coming together and making something beautiful. So you can use your creativity. You don't have to be tied to the established. So right here, here's another example. At the wedding, a bride and groom can draw something together. So this picture, it probably would have been nicer if I had done it myself, but I had a partner in it. And so we constructed this together. So this is something else that you can do at a wedding to demonstrate unity. I hope that was as fun for you as it was for me. We can take questions.
I want to return to the previous speaker, Sister Titania. And I want to make reference to what Brother Michael was saying. In some places in Africa and in the Southeast, India, I know for sure, dowries are a big thing, right? And I noticed that you didn't really spend too much time on this aspect of a wedding ceremony. How important you think this should be? And by the way, you give a very informative presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. So dowry was not one of the traditions we had up. However, as you mentioned, that there is a part in the, when someone mentioned giving away the bride, the reason why the father could give away the bride was because during that time, as long as you're under your father, you are his property. So he had to give you away. In the same way with the dowry, that's the idea. As a female, you are the property of under your father, and the dowry is an exchange of property.
And it is for that reason why a number of women have rejected having their fathers walk them up the aisle. That's why they have rejected having anybody walk them up the aisle. They say they're nobody's property. They're individuals. I will walk myself up the aisle. Pastor.
Yeah, let me just say something as it relates to the whole matter of the giveaway father. The background to the whole matter of giving away father, I know there might be some historical aspect to it, but when you talk about giveaway father, you must have the understanding that the father would have played a very important role in the child's life. It means that he was a source, protector, and provider. And so you notice that on the day of the wedding is the father who takes the daughter up the aisle and give her to the husband, which means, look here, I am giving you my daughter with an understanding that you will provide for her, you will protect her, and you will care for her. That's the old concept, the biblical concept of why we say the old matter of giving away father.
But does it have to be the father?
I do understand what you're saying. It doesn't have to be the father, but that's the understanding. Because there, look here, in a home, you will always have a father. A mother cannot be a father. A mother cannot be a father. Cannot be a father. That's Bible. A mother cannot be, you may act the role of a father, but you can't be a father. So in the context of the scripture, the man is a father, he is the provider. Because remember now, the father represents God. So the marriage, you need to see, sorry, Miss Moderator, you need to see marriage in the context of Christ with the church. Because Christ is the head of the church. And the text that Pastor read earlier about the one taking care of the bride and that sort of stuff, you have to look at it from that context. And so the gentleman takes the lady and says, I will now provide for her I will know. That is why I say, you can now be seated, because this man will now take care of the woman.
I just want to add, the meaning is very great. However, because of that meaning, a lot of females have felt ostracized. Some females don't even want to get married because they don't have a father to stand up for them, and they don't have a male figure to stand up for them. And they feel alone when they have to walk down the aisle.
I do understand that, sister. Nothing in this world is perfect. Nothing is in the world is perfect. So I hope you understand. But that's a background to it.
I just want to say, though, that there is absolutely nothing in the Bible, certainly from what I've read, that have supported or there's evidence of a giveaway father in a marital setting. I would want somebody to point me to that sort of evidence in the Bible. It is a construct that has come with Western civilization. Also, you know, the Bible is very simple in terms of how we should go about marriage. But because of civilization, we have added a whole lot of things to it. And that is fine, you know. But if two individuals should decide to go the traditional way as prescribed by the Bible, that is, a man takes a woman who he loves and the woman loves him, and they decide to join in holy matrimony, that is just as fine, no ring and all of that sort of fandangles. That is fine and should not be scorned or scoffed at. Because I will tell you, some of those marriages that have lasted for a long time are those without the fanfare. Because the individuals are in it for the love. They are not in it for the like and the whims and fancies of the world. And so we have to be very careful in terms of all the trappings that we support where marriage is concerned. And I am fine with either way, you know, but I just want to make sure that people who go into marriage understand that it is a serious institution of lifetime commitment that is holy, that is honorable, and is endorsed by God, and you don't play around a marital institution.
Amen.
Say something. Thanks, brother. You made a very important point. But the text that we can use, which would support my thesis, if I could use such a word, the Bible says, leave your father and your mother. You may not see a text which says you must have a giveaway father. You will not see that. But of course, there are principles in the scripture. I know it's tradition, but of course, it goes with an understanding that if marriage is a family affair, it's always a family affair. It's a family affair. You're joining this family to this other family. And even though you're joining families together, you still have that kind of individuality. Of course, I agree with the speaker that talk about you don't have to have the fandangles and all those things. Because when I marry people, my weddings are in three stages or categories. You have the religious part, you have the legal part, and you have the fun part. So I don't mix everything together, because we see marriage as sacred. But you have some fun to it also. So it's not so much a contract. It's not a contract for me. Christian marriage is not a contract. It's a covenant which God is in it. And so it is from that perspective, when I marry people, I make sure to tell them, look here, it's not so much a contract, but it's a covenant. So we go through a lot of counseling and let you understand that this is not in the river on the bank. It's a contract. It's a covenant between God, yourself, and your spouse.
Thanks for sharing, Pastor.
Just to add before we move on, Traveen. So it was mentioned that we don't have a scripture that says, you know, the father is to give away the daughter. But you mentioned earlier that God is very specific, and I believe that he is. And it just takes back my mind to the Garden of Eden, where the man was created first. He was, you know, made to sleep. God created his partner and brought her to him. And he, you know, became a little poetic to say, you know, this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. So to me, my understanding and appreciation of it is that the ultimate father gave away the woman to the man that he created.
That's a good perspective. So we just heard from, Brother Caballero, and then we will go on to our final presentation.
Thank you very much. Two quick observations. As I listened to a great and informative presentation from the ladies, and I am also picking up a very strong, a very decisive approach to recognize diverse approaches to women's rights as regards contract and marriage. And I trust the men inside here, especially in my age group, are becoming more and more aware that ladies, the postmodern woman, is very conscious, is super hyper-conscious of anything in history or contract that is patriarchal, etc. So we have to investigate it and make ourselves more aware, because the four brilliant ladies up there are very conscious ladies. But I warn us as men to be very careful and be aware that we live in an age where the origins and history, things have changed now, and women will get upset if they hear any contract or any tradition which does not validate the rights of women. And so I'm enjoying that debate because it's an educational experience for all of us.
Contract is not a bad word, you know, Brother Caballero. Contract is not a bad word. When you qualify it as a sacred contract, then we're fine. Yeah. Because a sacred contract is of God. So contract is not a bad word.
No, I wasn't going on that line at all. But yes. If you missed the flat of my ball, that's okay. I was talking about the whole idea of the traditions. Many of them came up at a time of male dominance. So I understand the modern woman needing to express her rights. Two quick things now. Number one, you mentioned jumping the broom has been done as an alternative form of marriage because the society in slavery did not respect slave marriage. I wish we had maybe at some part two, as we go into emancipendence and beyond, our National Heroes Day, you could spend some time talking about the effect of our history. And I don't mean Jamaica, the South, the political South or the socioeconomic South, or the geographic West as opposed to Europe, or black versus white. For example, you first mentioned us to a quick Google a while ago, and I was just noticing that the slaves, at least in the English New World, I think the Spaniards, and gave a little, being more Catholic, would have given a little more rights to marriage. But the English, they were focused on economics. So a slave could not enter into a contract because they had no rights. And marriage is a contract legally. And as such, they were using informal means of jumping the broom. Of course, where it was permitted, depending on the will of the master, but a master could change their mind tomorrow and sell one to Westmoreland, another one going to St. Thomas. And somebody could back me up. I need to do some more. I like to be based on exact history. But at least in America, it was brutal. And I was just looking at an account of a man who, because he couldn't afford, well, the man was hijacking him, he to pay more and more money. He couldn't pay it. And it was so tearful, his description, a former slave. He's now so tearful to say he walked with his wife for 4 miles in tears because she was sold elsewhere and she could not go. And so when I look at his history, I can understand why I jump in the broom then, because they could not be having a recognized marriage because they couldn't enter into a contract. 60 years of independence, 180 years of emancipation. It's a good time for us to talk about these things because this British and Scottish and Irish is great. But let us now, in our new world, in our brave new world now, look at Chinese, African, Middle East. And if I had a little more time, I'll tell you about the wedding I went to when I was in Egypt. God bless you. I'll chat enough.
Thank you so much. So we must move on to our final presentation by Sister Shelley Ann Morris. We're going to be dealing with the issue of unequally yoked, a sacred tradition, and Sister Shelley is going to remind us about this very sacred tradition, custom, exhortation, straight from the Bible.
Let us pray. Great God of the universe, we're thankful to thee for the institution of marriage. We're thankful to thee for the admonition and counsel you have given us. I pray, O Lord, that you will give us the ability to discuss such a sensitive topic while still understanding that you love us and you do all things for our good. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering this prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. There's no Seventh-day Adventist who has not heard the word unequally or the term unequally yoked. We all know the scripture, 2 Corinthians 6:14. Be what? Not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Some persons believe that this scripture is not only for marriage. Some persons say it is not only for marriage, it is for business, it's for friendship, it is for whatever relationship we happen to be in. Given our context of Adam and Eve today, we will look at it as looking at marriage. Now, what is the definition of unequally yoked? What are the questions we must ponder? And what are we supposed to believe at Seventh-day Adventists on fundamental belief number 23? Who is a believer? What are the admonitions from our patriarchs and from God himself? What are the pros and cons of being unequally yoked? And of course, we have to pray again, and then we will take some questions. Now, to be yoked meant that you were what? It usually related to oxen, cows, two animals yoked together to pull, to perform a task. Jesus's followers, early Christians, would have seen this in practice, would have seen cows, oxen, yoked together, pulling, plowing fields, acres and acres, getting the job done. So when we are unequally yoked then, applying it to cows, it means that what? We are unequal in strength. One is perhaps weaker. One is perhaps taller, shorter. One is perhaps lame. So we cannot complete a task because we are what? Unequally yoked. This is the best picture I could find of unequally yoked. Some had a cow yoked with a donkey. Thought that was rude, but unequally yoked. So this one was what? One is pulling and one has decided that I've had enough, I'm sitting down. We can also have one being bigger and one being smaller. Now, what is the bottom line? What is my conclusion before I begin? That what? Christians cannot be partnered with unbelievers, because we will not be able to live the life that God wants us to live. The weaker partner, who is the unbeliever, sometimes will slow down and hinder the Christian, and our faith is not meant to associate with darkness. Yes, silence. So the questions to ponder: does God really care who I date, partner with, or marry? Yes or no? Hands up. Yes or no? Amos 3 verse 3 says, can two walk together except they be agreed? Yes or no? Really? Can two walk together except they be agreed? Yes or no? Ah, ambivalence. So I will ask it again. Can two walk together except they be agreed? Think about it and go back to the picture of being yoked together. Can two walk together except they be agreed? So what do we believe about marriage? Thank you for going back to slide 9. This is what the Seventh-day Adventist says. This is the new edition. What we believe, being mindful of its word, it's printed by our Inter-American Division Press. So we now have how many beliefs? 28, moving from 27, and this is number 23. It comes under marriage. We've heard it before. Marriage was what? Established in Eden, affirmed by Jesus, and it is a lifelong union between a man and a woman in loving companionship. Now, for the Christian, a marriage commitment is to God as well as to the spouse and should only be entered into between partners who share a common faith. Mutual love, honor, respect, and responsibility are the fabric of this relationship, which is to reflect the love, sanctity, closeness, and permanence of the relationship between Christ and his church. And it goes on. But that is the introduction, and that is the beginning of fundamental belief number 23. You can check it. It is in page 256. And unit 4, Dr. Greaves, who was giveaway father, we spent the first part of the pandemic studying the 28 fundamental beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. What we believe about the family then, and marriage. So we say it again, man and a woman. Genesis, we just studied Genesis quarter 2, book of the beginnings, man and a woman. Genesis 2, 21, 24. God himself gave Adam a companion. Pastor mentioned it. Marriage is a covenant. Malachi 2, 13 to 14. God uses the image of marriage to illustrate the bond that unites him to his people. He is our husband. We find that in all those Old Testament and New Testament, even the one that we as women struggle with, in Ephesians 5, 25 to 33, it talks about what love, submission, and it says that the man is to love the church. Rather, the man is to love his wife as how what? God loves the church. And finally, the marriage relationship is the highest form of intimacy between a man and a woman. There is no other relationship, not between your mother and your father, your sister, your BFF, no other relationship. It's the highest form of intimacy. Your husband or your wife will truly see you. Not the facade, not the makeup. They will see you. Now, who is a believer? In the New Testament, that's right, he sees me. In the New Testament, the believer is a person who is convinced that what? Jesus is the Messiah. We know that. You have experienced the new birth. If any man be in Christ, he's a what? New creature. All things are what? Passed away, and all things have become new. The true believer hears the word of God. It impacts their life, and they what? Take up their cross, and they what? Follow Christ. And the believers seek ye first what? The kingdom of God and his righteousness, and what? All these things shall be added unto you. Matthew 6, 33. And we have access to the Holy Spirit, comforts us, guides us, provides admonition, and we have found the narrow road which leads to life and what? Not to destruction. So who is a believer? Bottom line, a believer, a Christian believer, is someone who believes and accepts the Lord Jesus Christ. But within believers, you have Pentecostal, you have denominations, denominations, rather. You have your Pentecostals, you have us, the Adventists, we have the Methodists, we have Baptists, we have Lutherans. In fact, there are 45,000 denominations according to the Center for the Study of Global Christianity, and that was in February 2021. There are 45,000 different denominations. So what am I proposing? So if I am to be unequally yoked with a what? I can be unequally yoked with a non-believer, and I can be unequally yoked with a believer, because yes, we believe in God, and then from there, what? We branch off into our what? Fundamental beliefs. And that can also be a sticking point. Now, what was the admonition from the patriarchs? God told the people of Israel not to intermarry, plain and straight. Deuteronomy 7, he says, do not give your sons and your daughters to them. Do not marry them. We know Samson and the unbelieving women, Delilah, Judges 14, a horror story. We know what happened. I love Samson. Samson is one of my favorite Bible characters, but what a way to end up with all that potential. Then we have Solomon, and the Bible says his love for what? Strange women, unbelieving women, 1,000 of them. Read the story in 1 Kings 11. And they drew away his heart from the Lord, and he was not as faithful as his father David. That is what Jesus also had against Solomon. And last quarter, we looked at Abraham, who was insistent that his son Isaac would not marry an unbelieving wife. And he sent his steward thousands of miles to find a believing wife for his son. And he also sent away his unbelieving children, who would not corrupt Isaac. And finally, if you want to read a true story of how harsh this can be, check out Ezra 10. When the Israelites came back from captivity, Babylonian and Persian, they had married a lot of strange women. Ezra called them together and told them to put away the strange wives that they had among them. And they did. To me, that is a tough story, but check it out in Ezra 10. Now, how does this relate to me today? Does Jesus really care who I marry, who I date, who I sleep with? Does Jesus really care? We say God cares. I know he cares. Does Jesus really care who I date, who I marry to? As a Seventh-day Adventist believer, that is the question we need to answer. So I looked at the pros of being unequally yoked. If you marry the person, you marry the one you love and who loves you. You build a life, you acquire assets, and we start a family. And my partner may find God, and I get to model a godly lifestyle. What are the cons? So I disregard God's admonition in the Old and New Testament, and there is no true intimacy without spiritual intimacy. You can challenge me on that. One is yoked to Christ, and the other is yoked to who? We have a divided household. You can challenge me on that. Will we attend the church and minister together? You can challenge me on that. And will all that I do be to the glory of God? You can challenge me on that, both from my home of origin and my marriage today. So, harsh words, sensitive subject. No one likes to talk about it. I thank Sister Trevine for this awesome opportunity, because it is a sensitive and a painful subject. And so we will close with prayer, and then we will take the questions. And we just say, Lord, thank you for your words, but we thank you for your grace and for your mercy. I pray, O Lord, that we will be able to put aside our love of self and to listen to you and to marry those whom you would want us to marry. Bless us now, we pray, and clothe us in our right minds, renew our right spirit. spirit within us, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Senator, you have the first question or comments.
Now I realize why I marry who I marry. You know, there's something that I have been observing in the church where a lot of young men, young women, have been saying that they can't find any partner in the church. And so they turn their eyes outside to look elsewhere. And in the process, when you ask them what it is that you're looking for, and they list a number of things, and you realize that it is more material than substance. They want somebody who is able to buy them a car, buy them a house, and all of that sort of stuff. So I said to myself, it is that they are venturing into relationship for the wrong reasons. And I want to implore young people, I'd say to them, yes, it is important that you want to make sure that you have a sustainable marriage. But a sustainable marriage is not hinged on just purely material things. That sustainability is going to be dependent on your relationship with God. You know, for years, I've been in the Adventist church. From 1991, I got baptized. Never wanted to get married immediately, no. But my eyes were opened to prospects. And it took me 20 years before I set my eyes on the one. Because I was single and she was single, and I heard people saying that, boy, well, a friend of mine, I heard her saying that this young lady was single. And I said, what? You're joking, man. And may I tell you, pastor, may I have to make the move, you know, because she represented what, as a Christian man, I was looking forward to in a daughter in Zion. And I say to my brothers and sisters, when you wait upon the Lord, he shall renew your strength. And it's just prayer and supplication. So young people, don't rush it and go out and talk about, say that no good man no in the church, nor no good woman no in the church. And the devil are full up yourself, your mind with lies and leading you down the wrong path, because you will find no other church denomination with the level of professional men and women as the Adventist church. It is just for us to go out and explore. You might not find the person at Andrews, go a Kencott. And if you go a Kencott and don't find the one, go a Meadowville. And if you go a Meadowville and don't find him, go a North Street. But somewhere in the church, God have good men and good women out there waiting for you.
Amen, amen. We have two more comments here. I'm going to ask you, gentlemen, to keep it short because we are now entering into the other time. So 30 seconds, please.
All right. I just wanted to add that
When somebody is looking for a partner in the church, we ought to involve God in all of that. When the marriage starts, it starts with God. So the courtship should also start with God. Because one thing I have to say, you can be unequally yoked in church.
Well said. Pastor?
I won't deal with that part. I endorse everything Senator said a while ago. You can find the man in the church and the woman in the church. Right here they are. But just let me say something here. We're having a lot of problems as it relates to family lives in the church. A lot of divorce taking place in our churches, which we're trying as best as we possibly can to encourage the whole matter of forgiveness. One of the biggest things that creates divorce is forgiving heart. That's one of the biggest thing. But let me just ace down to say, I won't take much time, but a key thing when you're looking for somebody, there are two main things you need to look for: character and chemistry.
Seconds, Brother Michael. Thank you, yeah. Pastor.
On the note of unequal yoke, does it has to be one person outside of your, let me say, religious belief? Because I had this friend. He was a Seventh-day Adventist, and his wife was an Anglican. And, you know, I remember talking to him one day, you know, before he left here, that he has to reach home before his wife arrived, because, you know, it was her birthday, and he wanted to, you know, greet her as she walked in for her happy birthday present. So I think there can be two different persons from two different denominations, but they're not unequal. Our his marriage has worked to the point where one died last week and the other one died the other week.
I want to say one thing. Can you see me? You can see me. Okay, when I talk to my friends about people they're dating, I always say to them, I always go back to the Ten Commandments. It says, you know, you should keep the Sabbath, you and your son and your daughter, and also the people that live within your house, people who are staying in your house and such. And I said to my friends, you can't have someone who is in the house with you, lives with you, and isn't keeping the Sabbath or isn't following your faith. So I always tell them that. I'm always telling my friends that. Another thing, another resource that is very good is the Amazing Facts Study Guide. Study Guide 5, A Key to a Happy Marriage. I recommend that everyone reads it, married or not. It's really good. So I just wanted to say that.
Well done, Gabby. I think you answered Brother Michael's question. Well done, Gabby.
As I said, it's a sensitive subject. The matters of the heart, the matters of emotion, chemistry, as Pastor says, it is not an easy decision to make. So in dating, it's a taste. You have to acquire a taste for godly things, for godly people. I used to date non-Christian men. You have to acquire a taste for Christian men. And the Lord had to take me through a process of understanding that I needed to be married to not only a Christian man, but a Seventh-day Adventist Christian man. Because I grew up in a household where my mother converted. She had married the Badventist. He married a Methodist. And God bless my grandmother, beautiful Seventh-day Adventist woman who spoke to my mother, got her interested, and converted her through God's grace to the Adventist religion. That is how we came in, because my father would never have introduced us, given the current life he was living. So I decided I could do it. My mom was doing it. Daddy was a good provider. He was very moral. He reprimanded us all on our bad behavior. We had to go to church. And I said to my mom when I was 15 or 16, I said to her, Mom, when I'm older, I'm going to marry a non-Adventist because you are doing it and it works. She said to me, you have no idea how lonely it is. It is a lonely situation. There is no true intimacy. I cannot speak to your father about religious matters. We are not going to pray together.
He's watching Oliver at large Friday nights. We are trying to have worship. He is dropping us at church and going about his business on Sabbath morning. She said it's a lonely existence and I sit in church every Sabbath by myself. I recommend that you not do it. Say sure. And I proceeded on my merry way. I was going to marry my non-Adventist because the men of corporate are more straightforward, way more debonair, and they see what they want. They go after what they want. And the Lord brought me down and said to me, this is not for you. This is not the taste for you, my daughter. And it was a taste that had to be taken out of my mouth. So I implore you, talk to God about it. And yes, there may be no men where you are, but this is not the only race. This is not the only church. This is not the only location, ladies and men. This is not the only country. This SDA church is not relegated to Jamaica. Dress and look your best everywhere. Supermarket, everywhere. Be always on the profile. Be always looking. Anyway, Brother Michael, I would not recommend it. I would not recommend it based on the admonition of Scripture and based on my own experience in my marriage. My husband and I don't agree on everything, but the big ticket items we are agreed on, and it makes life easier, and we experience a lot of intimacy because I can kneel beside him in the morning at my bedside and we can pray. He can pray for me, I can pray for him. Yes, you think we can do that different denominations, but we are gonna differ on many different things. And sometimes people don't like our religion. I found out that a friend at work may be married to an Adventist. I'm gonna speak to her. She's from another religion. They don't talk about certain things because what are the three big ticket things in a marriage? You can say four: sex, money, religion, and politics. So, know what you're doing.
Amen. And this is how we have to end our program this evening. We could legitimately speak for another hour. Sister, I'm sorry. You can speak with us afterwards, but we have to end it right here. We have to. All right. The public is in your favor. 10 seconds.
I apologize. The first and the last. Anyway, as I was saying, just responding to Senator's comment, he spoke about if it's not at Andrews, Kencott, wherever. I came in late, I have been listening, but it's kind of not so nice to be running, hopping, jumping around. So one of the things that I would say to all of us, because we have to be at a certain place to be in God's kingdom, we could also work on ourselves. So we don't have to be running up and down, but we could be actually suitable candidates to work on this self.
Thank you, Sister Simone. Brothers and sisters, the evening has been well spent. Thank you for being with us this evening. Did you enjoy AY this evening? Amen. Amen. Permit me to just take 20 seconds to thank our presenters, Sister Shelley Morris, Sister Shanique Blake, Sister Titania White. Allow me to thank the bridal party, Adam and Eve, the Martins. Want to thank our groomsmen for... Stand up, Adam and Eve. AKA the Martins. Want to thank our groomsmen, Asa Ricketts. Stand up, Asa. Leighton White, Tajwin Pusey, my best man Ransford, the bridesmaids, Sister Shanique Blake, Kamoya Little, Gabrielle Davis, yours truly, our flower girl, Sister Chloe, our ring bearer, Abraham and Sean Ricketts. Abraham and Sean Ricketts. And we want to thank our wedding coordinator, because you can see this was a serious wedding. Yes, Sister Sandra Cunningham, this beautiful gazebo, our bouquets. Sister Sandra, you are fantastic. Joshua, you know how you assisted. Our flowers. They all came from the garden of Sister Maureen Little. Thank you so much, Sister Little, our AY sponsor, parents of the bride, Dr. Greaves and Sister Little. We thank you so much. The groom was an orphan. That's why his parents were not here.
Thank you so much, everyone. Our wedding musician, Brother Brian Blaley. Continue to support the AY team. We're now transitioning very quickly to our evening's program. We will now ask for the praise team to come forward. And our minister, Pastor Blake, how could I? His very first wedding. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. We are going to turn to hymn number 183. I will sing of Jesus' love. I will sing of Jesus' love, sing of him who first loved me before he left. Christ was above and died on Calvary. I will sing of Jesus' love and his praise. My heart shall give me his life that I might live. I will sing his love to me. Oh, the depths of love divine, earth the rest can never know how to sing. As dark as mine can be made as white as snow, I will sing of Jesus' love and his praise. My heart shall give me his life that I might live. I will sing his love to thee. Nothing good for him I've done. How could he such love be so, Lord, I owe my now my love to show. I will sing of Jesus' love and his praise. My heart shall give me his life that I might live. I will sing his love to me.
Let's sing the chorus once more.
I will sing of Jesus' love and his praise. My heart shall give me his life that I might live. I will sing his love to thee. Amen. Just over the mountains in the promised land. Hymn number 642.
By God's own hand, as a weary footsteps in the mountains curse, we can do our home and of eternal rest. We are nearing home, we are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar, see the glory streaming through the gates ajar. There it soon will enter, nevermore to roam. Hear the angels singing, we are nearing home, we are nearing home. In the roles of the prophets we have long been told of that wondrous city with the streets of gold. Now with raptured vision we can see it there, with its walls of jasper and its mansions fair. We are nearing home, we are nearing home. splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. There is soon millennium, nevermore to roar. Hear the angels singing, we are near. Bring home, we are near. Bring home. Those who enter the city are the faithful few, who keep God's commandment, faith of Jesus too. There when lift your voices to the endless days, in sweet songs of gladness and in songs of praise. We are nearing home, we are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. Very soon we'll enter, nevermore to roam. Hear the angels singing, we are nearing home, we are nearing home. My brother, my sister, will you meet us there? In the land of sunshine where there'll be no care. Accept of God's message and to him be true. Then when Jesus cometh, he will call for you. We are nearing home. We are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. There is soon will enter, nevermore to roam. Hear the angels singing, we are nearing home, we are nearing home.
Amen. Hymn number 522, my hope is built on nothing less.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all on the ground is sinking sand. All on the ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to veil its face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all on the ground sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Final verse.
When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh may I then in him be found, clad in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
With the setting of the sun, we have entered into our second week of our health evangelistic seminar. Haven't we been blessed, brothers and sisters? Amen. We have certainly been blessed by the ministry of Dr. Stanley James in this amazing series, Lord, Clothe Me in My Right Mind. Our seminar continues every single night except Monday and Friday. And we just want to encourage our young people to come out on Thursday evenings, because that evening is dedicated solely to you, where we will be locked in sanctuary and not streaming. It will be a private session in sanctuary and on Zoom. Shall we pray? Father, we want to thank you for your care for every single element of our lives. Father, we give ourselves to you. We pray that you will put blinkers on our eyes, that we will remain fixated on you and fixated on the word that you have for us this evening. Move away all distractions, Father, and give us an encounter with you that will redound for many years to come until you return for your faithful people. We thank you for hearing and answering our prayers. Amen. I'm going to ask the praise team to come and do our theme song. And afterwards, we will hear from Dr. Stanley James another time. Please whisper a prayer for him.
Prisoner's chains with bleeding stripes, Paul and Silas prayed that night, and in their pain began to sing. Their chains were loosed, and they were free.
I bless your name. I bless your name. I give you honor, give you praise. You are the life, the truth, the
midnight hour. If you should find you're in a prison in your mind, sing out and praise. Defy those chains and they will fall. Jesus' name,
I bless your name. I bless your name. I give you honor, give you praise. You are the life, the truth, the way. I bless your name, I bless your name, I bless your name, I give you honor, give you praise. You are the life, the truth. I bless your name. name. I bless your name.
The Bible says in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 21, the importance of watching. If we look at Luke 21, verse 34, the Bible says, "But take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that the day come upon you unawares. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth." Verse 36. "Watch ye therefore and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Watch ye therefore and pray always." The problem we found in the verse before, verse 35. Let's look at verse 35. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Go to verse 34. "And take heed to yourselves, lest any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting." Anyone know what surfeiting is? Overindulgence, overeating, being excessively stimulated, becoming numb in the mind, and drunkenness. We tend to think that drunkenness means only drinking alcohol. Anything that confuses the mind and puts you in a state where you're not thinking clearly, you're drunk. Of course, the foods that we eat affects the critical thinking, the moral perceptions, your judgment. So surfeiting, this, the Bible is saying at the end of time, the devil will attack you with food and things that alter the mind. And I want you to know today, the number one problem that we have in healthcare is obesity and the lack of self-control. We know what to eat, but we just can't get patients to develop the self-control to eat it. There are many people who are overweight. They know what to stop eating, but they've lost total self-control. They have become overcharged, taken over, run over, steamrolled, broken, wheels in trouble. They are in a trap with drinking and eating. But not just that, when your mind is overcharged with food and drinking and not sleeping and stimulation, you have a problem. It says the cares of this life will crush you. If you want to learn how to have mental health, to resist and to fight against the cares of this life, you've got to say, what has taken over me? Because you don't have the willpower, the spiritual resistance, because of the foods that you're eating, the things that you're drinking, the lack of sleep, the inadequate sunlight, the inability to have fresh air, you have become overcharged. And not just people outside of the church, it's people in the church. Do you know the church knows more than many people in the world, but the church's healthcare statistics are just as bad as those people in the world? Why? Because I think that it's possible, verse 35, that the text says, verse 35, for as a snare shall it come. It has come like a trap that has caught you. It's come sort of like a web that you find yourself in. And if you're honest, you don't really think about what you eat. You just think, as long as I'm not eating pork, as long as I'm not eating shell food, I haven't had any lobster, I'm not eating unclean things. Because somehow you think that has something to do with your salvation. You actually think that the pork will contaminate you and it's a sin that's going to block you from getting to heaven. Pork and unclean meats have everything to do with health. It was in the Old Testament a symbol of sin, but the food itself has to do with health and disease. So the food itself is actually a standard of godly living to be healthy. The Old Testament youth, it was a symbol of sin. That's why they had prohibitions, but it also was a health prohibition, a dual application. One, it can make you sick, but it's also a symbol to teach about sin and sanctity. But eating pork is just as bad as eating sugar, because the sugar, which turns into alcohol, once mixed with the right foods, can cause you to become overcharged with surfeiting, come on somebody, and drunkenness. That you're overeating, even if it's on Sabbath, can cause you to be overcharged, come on somebody, with surfeiting and drunk. Is it possible that you've been drunk even on Sabbath and haven't drank no alcohol? Because the food has benumbed your moral perception, crippled your faculties, put you out to sleep, and a day which was the date of God, his most sacred day to spend time with you, you were overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness, and you went and had lay activities instead of spending time with the Lord. Now, I know you don't like that. I just messed somebody up. Verse 35, for as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the earth. 36, watch ye therefore. It's a prohibition. It's a warning. Don't just watch, but you got to do something. You got to pray. Power does not come from watching. Power does not come from warning. Power does not come from knowing the end time, the Sunday blue law, the papacy. That's not going to give you power. You may be watching and still not be ready. The text says you got to fill yourself with something. You got to what? Pray. Pray how often? Always. That ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass. And to stand before the Son of Man. I want to focus today on a subtle trap. It's called it's going to be talking about the entertainment trap. But I want to talk today on a PowerPoint presentation. If they can bring that up for us. If you've got the other one up, we can go with the other one. That's fine. For the sake of time. I want to talk about how to be free on the inside. What if you have been overcharged? Have you been overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness? Maybe you've got an addiction that you cannot break. Maybe there's a habit that has already ensnared you. I want you to know today, I can help you get free. Somebody should say amen right about there. If there's something that you know you're struggling with that may overcharge you, may wipe you out, I can actually help you today to be free. We're going to learn some basic strategies how to break chains that can hold you down so that you can watch and pray. Changing bad habits, not temporarily, but for good. Habits are friends when they're good ones. You know, every culture that builds are trying to build in their children good habits. When I watched the Chinese people when I was in medical school, they always kept their kids close to them. And the kids were taught very early Chinese language. And then they were taught how to work in the kitchen at the house. They were learning very good habits. I saw that also at the Indian community when I was in medical school and residency. The Indian teachers that taught me, they always had some grandparent or somebody teaching them the ways of the tribe and the community. And I began to observe that people that do well train their children early in discipline. You know that people are not necessarily brighter than you, they just have got more discipline than you. I've discovered that some of the people who've got the best grades weren't the brightest people, they just had good habits early. Did you notice that? As a matter of fact, even in sports, there are people that are very talented, but they don't go far because they're not disciplined. I'll say it again. There are many singers and musicians who are very talented, but they didn't develop habits very early. If you want to know why we as Seventh-day Adventists actually teach dress reform and diet reform, why we teach entertainment principles, because we know that the mind operates from cause to effect. We understand the very laws of nature. So early we teach our children there's some things we want to expose you to. There's some music we're not going to let you listen to. There's some places we're not going to let you go. Because once you start taking the habits, they're going to be with you forever. So our kids tend to do better all around the world because very early we have read books that teach you how to eat, how to dress, what television programs to watch, what music to listen to, and what moral practices to put into place. And once you put these laws into practice, on automatic pilot, you can outdo those people that don't know the secrets of habit. Now, habit change does not mean heart change. Conformity does not mean conversion. But just because it's not conversion does not mean we don't need conformity. What am I saying? Children, when they're very young, it's too early to teach them about the Holy Spirit transforming them. We don't know when that takes place. So while the heart is being worked on by the Holy Spirit, the habits are being worked on by the laws of the parents. We develop cultures of discipline so that when you get converted, you can be discipled even better. So habits are our friends when they are good ones. Habits are the greatest economizer of energy. If you want to save energy, just find the laws and make it a habit. The law is not done away with. The law is your best friend. Why? The law is the transcript of his character. Because the more you learn the secret laws of how to run faster, you will run faster. If you learn the laws of the economy, you will make more money. If you learn the laws of health, you will live longer. If you learn the laws of relationship, how a woman works, you will have a better marriage. Don't try to change the woman into being a man. Understand the laws of how she works, and your marriage will be much better. Understand the laws of how a man works, and you'll find yourself in less conflict. When you're ignorant of the law, is no excuse. You still have burdens. So if you learn the laws of relationships and health, science and spirituality, you do better. Habits are routines that help us repeat safe and effective behaviors and build consistency and security into our lives. Still talking about clothe me in my right mind. A mind that is not disciplined early becomes a very unstable mind. The reason why many of our young people are showing up with anxiety, depression, PTSD, finding themselves having lawlessness and oppositional identity is because early in their childhood, their parents have exposed them to unnatural laws on television, social media, internet, and their brain is becoming disorganized as opposed to be developing habits that are natural, that build for good character. And so we're going to have a big explosion. Many young people who are not exposed to these principles are going to have laws working against them as opposed to laws working for them. Am I making sense? A classic addiction. For example, alcohol. We've seen a lot of people who are addicted to alcohol. It's not even something people talk about much, but it's all around. Of course, cigarette smoking is another addiction. It's probably the most powerful of all addictions because our brain has neuroreceptors that are stimulated by the particles that are in the cigarette smoke, and we fall into a habit that we like it. It hits a pleasure center. Drugs. Substance abuse is very rampant. Cocaine, heroin, marijuana. Some people are using prescription drugs, and those prescription drugs that were meant for pain and sleep have become some people's best friends, and they can't break them. Drug use is not a necessary and sufficient cause of addiction. It is improper to consider drugs as the necessary precondition for addiction. In other words, just because you've been using the drugs, it doesn't mean that you are destined to be addicted. Not everybody that uses a drug gets addicted. Some people can use a drug and they don't get addicted. So that tells us that our brain chemistries are different. Some people are hardwired to be addicted. The question is, do you know what's in your DNA? You're playing Russian roulette. You can take a gun, put two bullets in it, and spin the puzzle and start shooting. In other words, you don't know when it's going to hit you. To expose yourself to things and take a chance can put yourself and you may get the bullet. So it's better to learn the laws that govern our bodies and live according to the laws of health than to take chances and wind up a slave to a passion or a habit that can destroy your future. Addictions include persistent, compulsive behavior that is harmful or destructive, characterized by an inability to stop. In other words, you just tasted it and you can't stop. Now, I know that for you is Doritos for somebody. For somebody else, it's Pringles. For somebody else, it's cotton candy. Somebody else, it's mango. For me, it's mangoes. You know, they gave me mango. I just can't stop. I had some Nesberry today. I had star fruit today. I had mango today. Jackfruit was there today, too. But something about those mangoes, those Indian, East Indian mangoes, I struggle. I think I have a problem where I just can't stop. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. Everybody's got something. I don't know what yours is, but I'm confessing today because I know you got yours too. And at the right time, you'll pop up and say, Doc, I got my, don't tell too much. Don't tell too much. If it goes beyond mango, you know, write it on a paper, talk to the pastor. Want everybody to know your business. Say amen, somebody. Examples of these addictions. Well, food is an addiction for many people. Remember, someone can become overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness. In other words, you can become addicted. And when you become addicted, it destroys the mind's ability to discriminate, and you become overcharged with the concerns of this world. The reason why some people are depressed, overcharged with the concerns of this world, the reason why some people are wiped out, overcharged with the concerns of the world, is because the foods that you've been eating and the things that you've been drinking has become addicted to, and it's destroyed the mind. Pornography, a very popular explosion on the planet. Nobody likes to talk about it, but if we don't talk about it and everybody's doing it, we're never going to solve the problem. So I'm going to take off the preacher jacket and put on the doctor jacket. Pornography is a very common practice right now, and previously it was looked down upon with shame. Then there was a liberal views that came out and said, well, sex education should be done and people should practice exploration. So we have two worlds that are in contrast. There's a psychology world that says, no, pornography, masturbation should be practiced. It's self-exploration, self-exploratory. And then there's a conservative Christian world that says, no, it's bad, and they condemn and condemn and condemn. The problem here is the Christians who are trying to change behavior are using guilt and condemnation and shame without dealing with the fact that this is a human behavior that needs to be healthily understood and healthily experienced or healthily expressed. Before you start shaming somebody, you want to understand them. You need to give a person a safe place to be guilty but not ashamed. Because they're wrestling with biology, not theology. Oh, I'll say it again. They're wrestling with testosterone and estrogen. They're not wrestling with Timothy and Ephesians. Yeah, missed it. You're born with urges that are circadian, some things that come on hormonal patterns, some things that are produced that you have no control of. But you're sitting there ripe, and some things your mind has been conditioned with because you've become overcharged with things that you've seen. In other words, the devil has hijacked something natural and got you in an addiction in an unnatural way. And you become overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness on porn. Because a natural impulse will not be stopped with shame, guilt, and fear. Shaming a person will not stop them. You need to give them access to a power that can heal them. We've spent a lot of time telling people what they shouldn't do. Good advice. But having given the power to tell them how not to do it, good news. So the church has done more injury, making people spiritually sick, than healing, making people spiritually well. So people are waiting for Jesus to come, hoping that they don't do it one more time, and they go back to that habit because no one has given them the tools so they can be overcome, so they can overcome with watching and praying. Let's see if we can go further. Gambling, a very popular addiction. We've seen many great athletes who are caught up in gambling. And they lose houses. Many people have lost their family, plots of land, because they've gambled. It's an addiction. Shopping. I know some of you say, no, that's not an addiction. That's just what a girl does when she needs some therapy. Well, she said, that's right. Well, for some people, shopping, they shop and they cannot stop. I make a habit. I drop people off to the mall. I don't go to the mall with them. No, because 5 minutes is never 5 minutes. An hour is never an hour. It's always 2 and 3 and 4 hours. Well, what did you get? Nothing. They don't have anything in the store. With all those stores, you came back with that one little bag. Nothing down here. They don't have anything. So something is wrong. But I've seen other people got another problem. They've got long bags and bags and bags, and the credit cards are burnt out, and they still feel that I didn't quite get everything. Can we go around to the other mall? Really? Addictions. If you think you have an addiction, it's important to work closely with your health care provider. If you know you're out of control, if you got impulses that you cannot stop, if you're spending money that you don't have, if you're injuring yourself, or if you're violating your own conscience, you need help. God has designed the human brain, even in adulthood, with a powerful capacity to what? Reshape itself, learn, and grow new connections. You are not destined to death. A plan of redemption has been put into place. God placed in everyone a capacity to have a breakout, to break through, so that you can be set free. There's hope written inside of your DNA. There's power to really change. People want you to think because you've got a habit, you need to hide in a closet and you're stuck with it. No. God has put in you the capacity to make a shift. Experience, thoughts, actions and emotions actually change the structure of the brain. You know, one of the things you don't want to do is expose your child to something that's going to develop a bad habit early. Many of the people that we see today, and we see them in the newspaper, we see them on the street, and we see them on the internet, we've become accustomed to just seeing them. But we haven't asked, what is the consequence to that little girl who sees an athlete or sees a hip-hop artist and begins to grind and whine like her? What is the consequence when she begins to change her body and change her shape and tattoo herself up to look like that? When you keep chasing new images and new, you're going to lose your own identity. And when you wake up and discover that you had the best, But now what you've got is something that no one really wants. It's going to affect you. But we're so strung out in wanting to be accepted that we end up becoming unacceptable even by ourselves. It's hard because everybody wants to fit in. That's normal. But you're going to have to find out who do you want to fit in with and deal with the fact that you're going to be unpopular with people that are unhealthy. Say it again. It's okay to be unpopular with people that are unhealthy. Oh, I'll say it one more time. It's okay to be unpopular with people that are unhealthy. You've just got to be able to figure out what is healthy and what is unhealthy and decide you can be unpopular with unhealthy and just be satisfied with what is healthy. Most times, healthy is not very popular when you're young. Healthy is not very popular when you're young. When you get old, people look back and they look at what was unpopular, and that's what they wish they had. Application. There's somebody right now who has to make a decision. Are you going to say yes to peer pressure or say no? What am I saying? Somebody's going to ask you to smoke weed, and that's what's popular. But it's okay to be unpopular with something that is unhealthy. Did you get me? Somebody's going to have sexual pressure put on you, and you're going to be encouraged to participate in a sex act that you're not comfortable with. It's unhealthy if you're not married to engage in sexual intercourse. It's okay to be unpopular with what is unhealthy because unhealthy will make you sick. Oh, you don't hear that type of direct language anymore, do you? No one actually says it. Yeah, it's unhealthy to be sexually active before you're married. Just because people do it don't mean we should call it right. At least know that this is not what I want to do. Lord, help me to get to where I have to be. Everybody's going quiet on me. It's refreshing to hear the truth every now and then, am I right? Yeah, but that's true. It's not healthy. Well, ask your parents, ask your uncles, ask your aunties. You know, when they look back, they say, yeah, that person wasn't worth all of me. I don't even know where she is. I don't know where he is. We don't talk, and I gave them the best of who I am. And unless you're sure that this is the person that you want to make an eternal union with and potentially create a child that would live forever with and share the joys of exploration and discovery and intimacy and vulnerability and trust and excitement and security, unless you're sure and you're sure that that person is sure that you don't want to do a permanent thing with a temporary person. Just because we have done it don't mean we shouldn't say it's wrong. Call it for what it is and say, Lord, I need help to break a habit. Freedom keys. How do I get free? Well, create an environment. Internal, your outlook. External, your surroundings. You know, many of us have such a condemned mind that our internal mind and environment is not healthy. And because you feel bad about yourself, you're not going to achieve very high. Because you feel so condemned in your old Adam, your addiction, your affliction, your habit, your past, your parents, your poverty, your sickness, your suffering, you begin to think you only deserve that little. It's sort of like a $100 bill. If you crush it up and put it on the ground and step on it, if the $100 bill starts to feel like it's a $10 bill and starts to act like a $10 bill, it has lost value simply because of the way it feels. But the truth is, if you pick it up, blow it off, it's still a $100 bill. It's not how the $100 bill feels that knows its value. It's the value that the master has assigned to it. Application. I don't care how you feel about yourself. You've got to go to the bank and ask, what's my value? And when the banker called Jesus Christ says, I bought you with a price that cannot be repaid. That's your value. You need to go with the facts and not your feelings. You have inestimable value. That's the internal. But then you need to have an external environment surrounding that reinforce your internal reality. What am I saying? You need to be around people that speak life and not death. You need to listen to music that builds and not breaks. You need to watch programs that develops and does not destroy. Your internal, you have godly value, must match your external, which is a reality and truth. Many people are so wrapped up in television and media that they don't know what is truth and reality. Turn it off and go into nature. Open the Bible and find out what's truth. And then look and make a decision on what's healthy and what's unhealthy. Number two, create a lifestyle. Once you start saying, I have the value that I'm equal to God. What? Yeah. God said, I look at you just like I see Jesus. So that's your new internal. External, I keep myself in environments that are clean. I build relationships that are positive. Now you've got a conversation about truth and reality. Now you need to create a lifestyle. Yeah. Create connections with other people and God that are going to build you, not break you. If you've got a toxic person around you, just cut it off. Just cut it off. Stop apologizing for telling your destroyer, I got to go. Stop apologizing for quitting your abuser. Stop apologizing for saying no and blocking people who are taking the best of you from you. Because one day you're going to need every little bit that they took, and it's going to be gone to a stranger who's going to give it to somebody else. Jerry Shield at Lifestyle Matters Training, he actually communicated on this. Working construction in Canada, he found himself strung out in alcohol and found himself really in a bad way. Eventually, he had to turn his life around. He found programs that were positive and enhancing. He changed his diet, ate plant-based nutrition, because the foods that you overcome with surfeiting and drunkenness is the foundation of new neurotransmitters. If you eat a plant-based whole food diet, get off of saturated fats, sugars, and things and animal products, and start drinking water, you will begin to see that the very neurotransmitters that make the connections get healthier. On top of that, you need to clean your environment and start exercising. Do you know just by walking and exercising, you begin to regenerate the brain? I've started going up to mountain springs. Yeah, I'm telling you all everything I'm doing. I'm telling you, I'm got to do it too. I've been to mountain springs. The first day I went up that mountain, I came back and got in my bed and woke up 6 hours later. That is a mountain. And the next day, I really didn't want to go. I didn't want to, but my pride, the man came and picked me up at 4:30 in the morning. I said, I hope he forgot. He didn't forget. He said, Doc, are you okay? I said, yes, I'm okay. I was resentful. I was a little angry because that mountain, it's a lot. And he doesn't start like, you know, most people have their cars halfway up there and parked to the right. No, he parks it at his house. And I got to walk with him from his neighborhood up the hill to get to where everybody else is starting to start walking. And the problem with going up, I'm going to tell you my problem. I got to grieve here with you people because, you know, you did it to me. This is your mountain. Every time I think I'm finished, it's another corner. You know, and I know I saw that house before. I saw that house before, and I look and I see that. Now, how did we get to see that house a second time? But I pushed on through, and they got this wall up there. It's like a silver, it's a metal fence, and I just got to touch it just to let myself know I made it. But, you know, the second day I made it, I did much better. My sleep was better. I had more energy, more vitality. I just noticed that, you know, when you exert yourself and exercise, you regenerate the brain. The other thing I had this morning, I actually had a wonderful lady here brings me mangoes. And I don't know how many mangoes you're supposed to eat in a day, but everything she gave me, I've eaten them. I think I've gone a little bit too far because it's a lot of mangoes. She's a wonderful lady. God bless her soul. And keep them coming, by the way. And then I had this morning some coconut, and the top was cut off, And the guy here told me, you need to cut open the top. So this morning, you know, because I knew I was coming to preach three times, I said, I'm saved this because I need this today. And, you know, I drank that thing this morning, and that's why I'm still firing up here today. My third sermon, and I'm still on, and I'm still, am I doing okay, y'all? That was that water from that cup. What am I saying? The foods that you eat, the exercise you do, helps you not to be overcome with surfeiting and drunkenness. It increases your performance. It helps you to watch, come on somebody, and pray. So here he has restored relationships. Another major important part of breaking an addiction is not doing it alone. Find somebody you can trust. There's my friend. She's right over there. The lady gives me my mangoes. Find somebody you can trust and work with them through that addiction. He found a group of supportive people, and together they were actually able to make it. You know, there's power in a group. Did you know that everyone in this room is actually a recovering addict? Yeah, because we were born with a nature toward addicted towards self. I don't care who they are struggling with a fallen nature that's addicted to something. You don't have to know somebody's business, and depending upon how they're raised, they may be addicted to religion. But God wants to set you free. And who God sets free is free indeed. Create an environment, internal, overcoming negativity and cultivating what? Thankfulness is a major key to success. Sometimes you just need to say what? Thank you. You know, just by saying thank you, even if you're still struggling with an addiction, thank you for victory today. I don't know about tomorrow, and I messed up yesterday, but I want to say thank you for victory today. You begin to recruit neurotransmitters that create a new identity, a new reality, and a new platform for existing. And if you can start celebrating the victory today, counting those things which shall be as if they already are, seeing yourself as saved, not to be saved, seeing yourself as having been justified, not will be justified, seeing yourself sitting in heavenly places, not will get to heaven, begins the transformation of the brain. You've got to program your brain with the thoughts of success, and it starts of being thankful. Refuse self-pity. Don't look down on yourself and say, oh, woe is me. No. Say, I'm so glad I'm still alive. God can still do something with me. Focus on solutions. If you have an addiction, sometimes the solution is, I need to choose even though I can't change. Whoa, remember that. You can't change your old nature. You're born that way. Don't even try to rehabilitate it. But you can choose to be in your new nature. And guess what? You were born with that too. God born you and built you with a new nature, and it's Christ. It is the Christ in you. That's the hope of your freedom from your addiction. It's not going to be through trying to break this old thing. It's going to be trusting this new identity, which is in Christ. Practice new attitudes. You're not what you did yesterday. You're who God has declared you to be today. And he says, you're my child. You've been born again, and I'm giving you a new start. Finally, make sure your surroundings are helping you and not hurting you. You cannot lay in the bed with somebody and say, well, you know, we're going to practice celibacy. Why would you put yourself in that situation? We're just going to hold. That don't make no type of sense. Can I be honest? I'm being a doctor today, not a preacher, so it's not, you know, so you all don't feel like it's a conflict. What I'm trying to say is don't go to the bar and sit up at the bar and say, I'm just going to drink cranberry juice. If you know that's your addiction. Don't go hang out with your friends. They're smoking weed, and you say, well, you know, I won't inhale. It don't make no sense. Don't turn on hip-hop music that is programming your body to be impulsive, benumbing your senses, and say, well, it's just music. Don't watch television programs that put symbols and images in your mind of a man and a woman, or a man and a man doing things that are contrary to your moral values, and think somehow or the other you're still going to override it with your intelligence. You are programming your brain with everything that you see. It leaves an imprint, and you don't know what it does to the subconscious and what addiction is going to show up. Don't expose yourself to habits that are destructive if you're trying to make it to when Jesus comes. Remove temptation. The text says flee. The word verb is fuego. It means flee as if you are jumping out of a building that was on fire. Because temptation will eventually warm you up and burn you out. I think that's a pizza. Somebody say goodbye to your pizza. Just say goodbye. Just say. Say goodbye, pizza. You know that's you. That's you. That's your Oreo. I don't know if that's your Oreo. I don't know if that's your pizza. I don't know if that's your donut, whatever it is. Just somebody wave it. Wave. Just wave. 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 Just wave. Say goodbye to you. Yeah, yeah. So we got, everybody got something. I don't know what yours is, but put it in the garbage. Yeah, see, more coming. More stuff. External. Make sure your surroundings are helping, not hurting. Remove temptation and replace with positive. You've heard the story that there was a man who had a demon in him. And the demon was in the house. And he's able to get that demon out. And the demon went around circling and circling and circling and circling until it came back to the place that he left. And because the house was empty, he brought back 6 more demons and locked it down. If you don't replace your negative with a positive, the vacuum will be filled back with the old negative. You're going to have a relapse, and it's going to be difficult to break it again. You must replace your negative with a positive. Practice new behaviors. Just start practicing. Positive lifestyle choices protect the brain and the body, make it easier to cope with stress and enjoy new things to do in life. Finally, hydrate with water. More fresh fruits and vegetables, get your rest, daily exercise, create new connections with others, encourage positive choices, mentor and support yourself and somebody else, help you stay, all these things help you stay accountable. Connect with God and He will what? You know, one of the reasons why people stay stuck is because they feel that God is condemning them. And because you think God is condemning them, then God cannot help you. When you accept the fact that God has forgiven you, but I did it 1,000 times, God says, I'll forgive you eternally, because unless you experience grace, you're never going to experience deliverance. Unless you experience grace, you're never going to experience deliverance. Freedom starts with forgiveness. God has forgiven you. Forgive yourself to start freedom. Create new desires in you, empower you, and God will also guide you. Do you know if you ask the Holy Spirit, He would actually guide you and ultimately save you from your addiction? Yes, friends, what I want you to do finally is walk in His love, grow in His grace, and rejoice in His salvation. Somebody ought to say amen here today. I said, somebody say amen here today. For the Bible started out with, go back to the primary text that we start out with in the Gospel according to Luke. Watch ye therefore, and what? How often? I want you to remember, you need to stay in an attitude of prayer. What is that? An attitude of thankfulness, an attitude of grace. And remember, God has already broken your addiction at the cross. Walk in your new freedom. It's for yours to receive. Our God and our Father, thank you for what you did at the cross. You crucified our old Adam. You crucified our old addictions. And when you got up, we got up with you with a new spirit. Let us know that we are completely forgiven. And we can start trusting because we're watching and praying that we don't overcome this or fading in drunkenness and you will give us the victory over our habits as we pray. In Jesus' name, we say thank you. Let everybody say amen.
Amen, church. What are you doing with your mind? Tomorrow evening, our speaker will be speaking under the caption, Free Your Mind. Amen? And I'm sure you want to hear exactly what Dr. James has to share with us. This morning during second service, he made the appeal. He said that we have, and I'm paraphrasing here, that we have made a sacrifice to go to the supermarket, yes? And we've made a sacrifice to go to work and engage in entertainment. So if we can do all of that, then we can certainly make the sacrifice to be right here in Sanctuary. Once you're living in Kingston, St. Andrew, or St. Catherine, you can be in the Sanctuary. So we're looking forward to seeing you. Yes, brothers and sisters, bring a friend. Tell people what's happening. If you are here, then you can't be content just looking on your device. You need to be in the Sanctuary and feel the Holy Spirit moving. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? And so I'm making that commitment to be here, and I'm looking forward to seeing all of you here. We will end our service in fine style with our theme song, I Bless Your Name. Praise team.
Prisoner's chains with bleeding stripes, Paul and Silas prayed that night, and in their pain began to sing. Their chains were loose.
Truth the way, I bless your name.
Singing, what you say, church. I just want to thank all of you. I see my senior pastor, he's sitting there. Thanks, Pastor, for coming. I know you find this church to be a home church. Now, we're happy for you, sir. And I let my pastor meet you after we're through. But I just want to thank all of you for coming out this evening. Certainly, the AY was indeed a wonderful one. And I'm sure after this AY, we will have a lot of people getting together. That's it. And I'm happy for our leaders. What you say, church? I'm happy for our leaders. It's just a wonderful thing to be here. And I'm sure those who are online watching, this afternoon program has been a really blessing for all of us. We spoke on different areas in terms of family life. And as I often said, the families that stick together will stay together, not only here on earth, but we believe if they will even walk right into heaven together, what you say, church. And I want to thank God for the man of God, Pastor. We are indeed tremendously blessed. And I'm sure we have seen it on the internet that, yes, folks are feeling really, really well and they're blessed. And so we can't afford not to be back tomorrow evening, even online or we're here. But what we will really want to see folks in the temple. Hello? And I'm sure my first elder would agree with me that we want to see more people inside the church worshiping with us. But however, keep strong in the Lord and keep sweet in the Lord. Just one little thing, Pastor, coming up here. One little thing here. Pastor Allen's wife has some wonderful little thing that she would like you to support her. Some wonderful bars. Is it granola bars? Yes. And right at the door after we're through, you could support her. She has some wonderful things that we would like you to support her with.
I just want to thank those who have been online. We've appreciative of your presence. Many of the remarks have been encouraging to me personally. I review them and I read them. And we want you to know that while many people are international, there are people in California, people in Bermuda, people in other parts of North America and in the United Kingdom, if you're in Kingston, just pass by for a house call to see the doctor. And when you come, I want you to come. Just come, just to see the doctor. It's not going to cost you anything. And I promise you, I will be blessed. I just would like to have your Jamaican welcome, the presence to see you here, to make us feel very much welcome and more firm. It's been great. Thank you very much for what you've done and what you've done. But I also sense there's the presence of the Holy Spirit in the room. Haven't you noticed that, Pastor? I said, haven't you noticed that there's something actually happens when the people of God get together in a room? God's presence actually dwells. Come and enjoy and drink with us. Thank you very much.
Shall we just stand and repeat Psalms 19 in the last verse? Let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Again, please be seated. Remember the various announcements. I guess there will be exercise program tonight again. Oh, my leader is coming. Come on.